it's clear there. You see, the Holy Spirit was not yet given. See, in John chapter 7 and verse 39, the Bible says there, Jesus was not yet glorified. Now, as we study the word of God there, see, it's agreed with most everybody that the Holy Spirit was not given until the day of Pentecost. There's no debate about that, I'm sure. Now, as you turn over to John chapter 16 and verse 17, John 16, and we read here in verse 7, the Bible says here, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away." This is John 16, verse 7. "If I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart," see, Jesus has to depart. He has to go back to the Father. See, but he says, "But if I depart, I will send him unto you." So, again, see, that's future. See, the Comforter will not come, but if I depart, I will send him unto you. And then as you turn back to the book of Luke, in Luke chapter 24 and verse 49, Luke 24 and verse 49. Now, the Bible says here, "And beheld, I send the promise of my Father upon you." See, that's the promise, that's the Holy Spirit. But he says, "But tarry ye," or wait, "in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued," see, "with power from on high." See, that you be endued with power from on high. Now, but he said, "Wait in the city of Jerusalem." So the Bible is very clear that the Holy Spirit did not come in his fullness until the day of Pentecost. And that's when, of course, the Holy Spirit came. Now, turn to Acts chapter 2 and verse 4. Now, in Acts chapter 2 and verse 4, the Bible says, "And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost," Holy Spirit, "and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance." Now, again, see, that's, they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. What's that talking about? See, the coming of the Holy Spirit of God on the day of Pentecost. Now, we dealt with that many, many times, and obviously that has never been repeated, the day of Pentecost. And the gift there was the ability for every man to hear him speak in his own language. Now, and in verse 6, it says, "When this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded." Why? "Because every man heard them speak in his own language." Now, that has never been repeated in the history of the world. It's not being repeated today. Wasn't repeated then. Never been repeated in the history of the world. Now, but the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost, and that was the evidence that the Holy Spirit came. Now, there's no debate about that whatsoever. See, what happened on the day of Pentecost has not been repeated. See, people today, no missionary has the ability to go to a foreign language group that they have never known, they know nothing about, and be able to speak without learning the language, and then those people who do not understand the language, somehow they understand the language. So no one has that gift, no one had that ability, but that's what was done on the day of Pentecost, and that was an indication that the Holy Spirit came. And again, there's no debate about the fact that that has never been repeated, it's not being repeated today, and so forth. Now, before we go on, does anybody have a question or an observation in relation to that, the coming of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost? See, the fact that that was languages and it has never been repeated. See, that's very clear. Now, again, There's no debate about that. They were languages. That has never taken place again, you see, and certainly is not being taken place today. But now as we think of the Holy Spirit, see, we can never ignore the Holy Spirit, and we can never de-emphasize the Holy Spirit in our lives. Now, see, the Bible teaches very clearly that, you see, a Christian is zero without the Holy Spirit of God. Now, if someone is not controlled by the Holy Spirit, see, they're worthless as a Christian. See, there's no way they can glorify God and be a blessing to others unless they are filled with the Holy Spirit of God. For instance, turn your Bibles now to Acts chapter 5. And in Acts chapter 5, we read here, as we have mentioned it many times in studies, about Ananias and Sapphira. Now, the indication here is that they were saved. They were in the church. They were baptized. They made a profession of faith. And all the indication is, obviously, that they were saved. And the way Peter refers to them are as saved people. They were inside the church there. Now, in Acts chapter 5, the Bible says, but a certain man named Ananias with Sapphira, his wife, this is Acts chapter 5, sold the possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. And of course, again, I'm sure most everybody knows about the situation there. See, they wanted to be the head honcho. They wanted everybody to look upon them as being more spiritual than anybody else. Now, in the previous chapter, and it's an unfortunate chapter break here, see, that's what Barnabas did. Now, Barnabas was filled with the Spirit. He did it to help out the church. People were from all over the world at that time, etc. And so what we find there, he was filled with the Spirit, and he did it to meet a need in the church, and he laid it at the apostles' feet. Now, Ananias and Sapphira, see, they had evidently a very expensive piece of property. They sold it, and they didn't have to do it. Nobody told them to do it, but they did it, you see, and they kept back part of the price from the church, the apostles, and they faked it in thinking and telling them that they gave the whole thing. So they must be the most spiritual people in the church. But they held back, the Bible says, part of the price. Now, in verse 3, Peter says, Ananias, why hath Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price? Whilst it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not thine own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but see, unto God. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down, gave up the ghost, and great fear came upon all them that heard these things. Now, see, here was someone who was saved. And obviously, he sinned against God. But the Bible says here that Satan filled his heart. Now, what we're talking about, see, he was not filled with the Holy Spirit. He was filled with the devil. That's what the Bible says. Now, sometimes people misunderstand this passage in the Word of God, and they don't get a hold of it. See, but it's very clear. See, Satan filled his heart. He was filled with the devil. Now, he wasn't foaming at the mouth, and he wasn't rolling over in the on the floor or having a convulsion. See, they were looked upon as the most spiritual people in the church, but they were hypocrites. And obviously, their sin had a lot to do with the matter of pride. See, and of course, they were liars and pride and that type of a thing. And so the Bible says there, see, they lied to the Holy Spirit. See, they sinned against the Holy Spirit. And then you read another verse or two, and it says they lied to God. See, to lie to the Holy Spirit is a lie to God. But now, it's very interesting. You see, Satan filled thine heart. Now, that's a Christian. Can a Christian be filled with the devil? And the Bible says yes. See, and again, see, they're full of pride. They wanted everybody to pat them on the back and one thing or another. And Satan filled their hearts. See, they were filled not with the Holy Spirit. They were filled with the devil. See, which shows us very clearly that, you see, we're absolutely nothing unless we are controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. Now, before we go any further, does anybody have a question about that matter of Satan filled thine heart? Anybody have a question or a comment about that? See, Satan filled thine heart. See, it had to do with money. It had to do with greed. It had to do with pride. And those are things that the devil uses in the life of a child of God. So, and that's what he used here. But any question about that? See, they were filled with the devil. See, can a Christian be filled with the devil? And the answer is absolutely yes. If they have pride and greed and covetousness, then they are filled with the devil, according to this verse in the Word of God. And so we see that very clearly. See, a person is nothing unless they are controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. Then you turn over to chapter 6, and then you read here about the Holy Spirit. And here we learn about the practicality of the Holy Spirit of God. Very powerful teaching here in Acts chapter 6 about the Holy Spirit. Now, in Acts chapter 6, it says, "And in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplied, there arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews, because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration." See, the distributing the food, and the foreign Jews were neglected, and they seemed to be favoring the Jews from Jerusalem. "Then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them, and said, It is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables." Now, what that's talking about is distributing food to the widows that were in need, because they were gathered from all over the world at that particular time. Now, so he says in verse 3, "Wherefore, brethren, look out from among yourselves seven men of honest report," and it says, "full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business." Now, there I think we see some very powerful teaching about the Holy Spirit of God. Now, again, a lot of times people, when they think of the Holy Spirit, they think of doing something spectacular or some big thing or some emotional thing. But now here in the church at Jerusalem, they had a problem. And the problem was that some of the widows thought they were being neglected with the distributing of the food at that particular time. Now, most of the time we'd say, well, that's not a big deal. But it was a big deal. Why? Because the Bible says here in verse 3, it says, "Look out among you seven men of honest report, say full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business." Now, it says here, full of the Holy Spirit. Now, someone might say, well, what has the Holy Spirit to do in a situation like that? It's just talking about distributing food. But you see, that's the practical work of the Holy Spirit of God. Now, if somebody in that church at Jerusalem was going to take the food, say, to the widows, the Bible says they needed to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. Now, that's a practical thing. See, and what does that teach us? See, the Holy Spirit is practical. See, nobody's going to be a good Christian and nobody's going to be a blessing to others unless they are controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. See, nobody is going to be a blessing helping out poor people in the church or helping out widows that don't have food to be authorized by the church to go and distribute food to them. Now, you say, well, anybody can do that. No, anybody cannot do that. A person needs to be controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. Why? Because if they're not controlled by the Holy Spirit, they'll never be a blessing. They'll make a mess of it. They'll not honor the Lord. They'll not bless others. Now, there you see the practical teaching in the Bible about the Holy Spirit of God. See, someone might say, well, the Holy Spirit is only to do some big, mighty job for God. Well, here you find that you might say, to do a small job for God, you have to be filled with the Spirit. And if you're not, you'll mess it up and you'll cause hard feelings and you'll never be the blessing that you ought to be. Or you might go around and brag on yourself and say, hey, look, I'm the person that's helping out all these widows and be full of pride and that type of a thing. So, see, the Holy Spirit wants to control us for the little things in life. And many, what we would consider the little things, rather than some major big ministry, this would be considered a humble ministry, a small ministry. But at the same time, say they needed to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God for that particular ministry. So the thing we need to emphasize as we study about the Holy Spirit, see, immediately when we study about the Holy Spirit, we have the mistaken idea that the Holy Spirit is only for great ministry. You see, and yet when you study about the Holy Spirit, say he's for the practical everyday needs of our life. If we're going to be a blessing, you might say in a small way, you have to be filled with the Spirit. And if you're not, you'll not be a blessing to anybody. So that's an interesting passage in the Word of God. Now, before we go any further, does anybody have a question about that? You see, he said, the leaders in church said that if somebody is going to take the groceries to the widow and those that need help, make sure they're filled with the Holy Spirit. Because if they're not filled with the Holy Spirit, they'll cause more harm than good. They'll make a mess out of it. So, and to see the little things in life, comparatively speaking, which it's not a little thing, it's a wonderful ministry, but they had to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. Now, as you turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, and this familiar passage in the Bible, most everybody knows about it, but it's good to point it out. See, Paul is talking here about getting victory over sexual temptation. You read the whole chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, that's what he's talking about. For instance, there, as you read the Word of God, it's very, very clear. Now, in verse 18, see, he says, flee fornication. In other words, run away from sexual sin, which was very common in the church at Corinth. Now, and then he says in verse 19, what, know ye not that your body, see, is the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in you, which ye have of God, and you're not your own. Now, his response is that you can have victory over sexual sin through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, he goes on, and he says that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. A lot of times people use that verse, say that's why you shouldn't smoke and you shouldn't drink and so forth. In the context, it is talking about fleeing fornication. But then he says in verse 20, say you're bought with a price. Say you're saved through the precious blood of Christ. Therefore, glorify God, say, in your body. Say, and the emphasis there is on in your body. Now, what is he saying here? Say, you're having trouble with sexual temptation, and it's all about you in the city of Corinth. Say, the word Corinthian at that particular time was a synonym for somebody who lived an immoral life. Say, they were referred to as a Corinthian. Say, it was all over. It was, we think it's commonplace today. It was part of the society. Everybody did it. There are no rules against it and so forth. No laws against it. But see, what he's saying is now about the Holy Spirit is that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit dwells in your body. Just like the Shekinah glory, God dwelt in the tabernacle and the temple in the Old Testament. Now, you see, God, through the Holy Spirit, dwells in your body. The Bible says Christ liveth in you. See, and how? Through the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Now, so he says, therefore, you can glorify God in your body. God can give you victory over sexual temptation. Why? Paul says here, because you have the Holy Spirit of God. See, that's the teaching here of this great verse in its context. So that you might glorify God in your body because the Holy Spirit dwells in your body, and because of that, you can and you ought to glorify God in your body. Now, turn to the book of Ephesians. Now, we're just pointing out some basics about the Holy Spirit here. Now, in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18, see, he says, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Now, that's a command in the Bible, and it's in the plural. And it means that everybody is commanded in the Bible, every child of God, he's writing to Christians in the church at Ephesus, to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. Now, that's a command, and it's in the present tense, and it's also, once again, it's plural. So he's saying that everybody ought to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, in the context there, which is a very important verse on the fullness of the Holy Spirit, see, he is not talking to preachers or pastors or missionaries. Obviously, you read that chapter in the Bible, and he's talking there to everyday Christians, Christians that go out and work and have a job and make a living, and mothers and fathers and so forth. See, that's the context there very clearly in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18. Now, again, I think a very interesting thing there and a very helpful thing there is that as you look at the context, it's Ephesians 5:18. Who is he saying, number one, should be filled with the Holy Spirit? Ephesians 5:18. Now, who is he talking to in Ephesians 5:18? Who should be filled with the Holy Spirit. See, he's talking to believers. He's talking to everyday Christians. See, now, as you look down in the passage, he, in verse 22, he refers to wives. See, now, a lot of times when we preach about the Holy Spirit, we say, well, the preacher needs to be filled with the Holy Spirit, and he does. That's clear in the Bible. He should be filled with the Holy Spirit. But do you realize the Bible teaches that wives need to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God? See, wives. And then in verse 25, he talks about husbands. See, husbands need to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. See, now what we're getting at, see, the Bible teaches that the teaching about the Holy Spirit is that the Holy Spirit's practical. Wives need to be filled. Husbands need to be filled. No matter who you are, you need to be controlled by the Holy Spirit. Now, obviously, in the context, he's not saying that if a wife is filled with the Holy Spirit, she will have some great ministry. See, it's not talking here about ministry at all. It's simply saying that if the wife is filled with the Holy Spirit, she will be a good wife. See, in the home, talking about her life, her ministry. See, it's not talking about some great ministry that she's involved in, but it means she will be a better wife in her home. Now, the husband, see, he talks in verse 25. See, and now it's not saying that the husband, if he's filled with Spirit, will have some great, powerful ministry. No, doesn't say that. It says that if he's filled with the Spirit, he'll love his wife as Christ loved the church. And someone has to be filled with the Spirit, see, to do that. Now, what we're talking about, see, a lot of people are all messed up on the Holy Spirit of God. See, they don't realize it has to do with our homes. It has to do with mothers. It has to do with fathers. So, and so forth as we read the Word of God. So the point that we wanted to make out, see, the practicality of the Holy Spirit of God. Don't think that we shouldn't think that we need to be filled with the Spirit to do some great ministry. Now, if you're taking groceries to a widow, you need to be filled with the Spirit. See, if you want to be a good wife, you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. If you want to be a good husband, you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. Then he goes on and mentions employees and employers. Now, so see, all of that brings us to the subject of how the importance of being filled with the Holy Spirit of God. Now, see, how is someone filled with the Holy Spirit according to the Word of God? See, what does the Bible say about people who are filled with the Holy Spirit of God? Now, when you look at Ephesians 5:18, you see, he says, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns, spiritual songs. Say, God will put a song in your heart and joy and peace in your life, singing, making melody in your heart, and then giving thanks. And you'll be a thankful person. You'll not be someone who is unthankful. Say, somebody like that. A lot of people are like that. And now, as you turn over a few pages to the book of Colossians. Now, in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 16, see, Paul says here, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another. And now he says psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, and in your heart to the Lord. And whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father by him. Now, as you study those two passages out, what you find is they are parallel passages. Now, Paul is saying basically the same thing in both of those passages. He's saying the same thing. Now, in the one passage in Ephesians, he says, be filled with the Spirit. But now in Colossians 3 and verse 16, he said, let the word of God dwell in you richly. Now in that passage, what he's saying is you need to be filled with the word of God. So it's very, I think, insightful as you study the Bible. Say, how am I filled with the Holy Spirit of God? See, and when you compare Ephesians 5:18, Colossians 3:16, say, to be filled with the word of Christ, the word of God, that's being filled with the Holy Spirit. See, the Holy Spirit has given us the Bible. It's inspired by God, the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will never lead anybody apart from the Bible. See, that if someone does something that's contrary to the Bible, the Holy Spirit's not in that at all, as we've been dealing with Sunday school recently. But now, see, this I think is very, very instructive. See, to be filled with the Word of God is to be filled with the Spirit of God. And if someone is filled with the Word of God, they will be filled with the Spirit of God. You see, that's the teaching of the Bible. Now, in John 17, 17, Jesus said, and prays for all of the believers, he said, sanctify them through thy word. Say, thy word is truth. Now, sanctified means set apart, to live a holy life. Has to do with living a holy life. Now, Jesus, in his prayer, how do we live a holy life? Say, he says, sanctify them, set them apart, make them holy. Say, by thy word, with the truth. And the truth is the word of God. Say, and we see this throughout the word of God. Say, anybody who is filled with the Holy Spirit is also dominated by the word of God. Say, no one filled with the Spirit deviates from the word of God. Now, Psalm 119:11, say, thy word have I hid my heart that I might not sin against God. Say, Psalm 1, the blessed man meditates on the word of God. He's dominated by the word of God. So now, when you study the Bible, how can I be filled with the Holy Spirit of God? How can I reach out and be controlled? And of course, the word filled means be controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. Be filled with the Bible. Read the Bible. Get into the Word of God. Read the Bible every day. Be in church to hear the preaching of the Word of God. See, and when the Word of God dominates us, then we will be controlled by the Holy Spirit. See, the Holy Spirit inspired the Bible. The Holy Spirit gave the Bible. And when we follow the Bible, that means we're controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. Now, how many times have you heard someone or had the experience, and it's not uncommon, where someone says, well, I know that's what the Bible teaches. And someone says, but I don't care. I'm going to do what I want to do. You see, I don't care what the Bible says. I'm going to do what I want to do. See, now that person is not controlled by the Holy Spirit. See, because to be controlled by the Spirit means you're controlled by the Word of God. And certainly we see that, again, what we've been studying about in Sunday school and Sunday morning, the matter of speaking in tongues. And the Bible's real clear in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 that if somebody speaks in tongues in the church, they must have an interpreter. See, and if they're just blabbing away and there's no interpreter, see, then Paul says that's not of God. See, that's not of the Spirit of God. It's not of the Holy Spirit. Why? See, the Bible should govern our lives. See, what is our guidebook? Our guidebook certainly and obviously is the Word of God. Now, you see, the Bible, again, is clear. How can I be filled with the Holy Spirit is to be filled with the Word of God. The more that the Bible dominates my life, the more I will be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, another obvious thing about being filled with the Holy Spirit is that we must be people of prayer. You see, and be a person of prayer. Now, for instance, as you turn back to Acts chapter 1. Now, before the Holy Spirit came and they experienced that great blessing of Pentecost, we read in Acts chapter 1 and verse 14. See, in Acts chapter 1 and verse 14, the Bible says here, these all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication. See, now where does the book of Acts begin? A lot of times we say it begins on the day of Pentecost with the Holy Spirit coming. No, It began in Acts chapter 1 in a prayer meeting. See, and they were praying. See, and then the Spirit of God fell upon them, but it was related to the matter of prayer and praying. The Bible is real clear. For instance, in Acts chapter 4 and in verse 31. In Acts 4 and verse 31, the Bible says, and when they prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they spake the word of God with boldness. But the thing there in that early church, you see, the fullness of the Holy Spirit is associated with prayer. See, and that again, you can't separate prayer and the Holy Spirit. See, if a person is a person of prayer, they will be filled with the Spirit. They will do what God wants them to do. Amen? Now, if I don't pray, I'll just do what I want to do. And I'll live the way I want to live. And I'll never be under the control of the Holy Spirit of God. So obviously, it has to do with the matter of praying. Now, as we saw last week, as you study about the Lord Jesus Christ, see, he was filled with the Spirit. He was led by the Spirit. He was empowered by the Spirit. But now, as you think of the Lord Jesus, see, over and over again, we find he was saturated with prayer. See, he was someone who prayed. And the Bible is real clear. See, you can never separate the control of the Holy Spirit from the matter of prayer. Now, as you go back to the book of Ephesians. Now, in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 18, be filled with the Spirit. But now, you see, there's one thing that Paul makes clear about the ministry of the Holy Spirit in the life of a Christian. And that's found in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 30. Now, and he says here, and grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby you are sealed unto the day of redemption. Now, see, that shows you the Holy Spirit's a person. See, the Holy Spirit can be grieved. We can hurt the Holy Spirit. We can hinder the Holy Spirit's ministry in our lives. Say, grieve not the Holy Spirit. That means what? That if you and I grieve the Holy Spirit, we hurt the Holy Spirit, we insult the Holy Spirit, then we can never be controlled by the Holy Spirit of God. Now, as you bring out that passage, it's very clear what he's talking about previously there. He's saying that before you got saved, you were a bunch of crooks and you stole. So now you're saved, make sure you don't steal anymore. You need to change your ways, because if you sit around, you don't get a job, and you're stealing, say, then you're never going to be filled with the Spirit. You're grieving the Spirit. And then the verse after is that famous verse, verse 31, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor. See, now you got to get all that bitterness and anger out of your life. Now, in verse 31, he says, be put away from you. And what he's saying, say, before you were saved, you were angry. You were bitter. You were mean before you got saved. Now, that's why he's describing these people. Now, there's nobody here this evening that would apply to. Amen? Say, none of us were bitter or angry or mean before we got saved. I guess the only one that was like that was me before I got saved. But that's true of all of us, amen? All of us, see, we were angry. We were bitter. See, we were vindictive before we got saved. Now, see, now Paul is saying, put it away from you. And the language there, what he's saying, is this is common among you. You are doing it. But see, you are responsible to get that out of your life. Like I mentioned to someone about a friend of mine that works on a job, and his boss curses him out every day on the job. I mean, the boss curses him out every day on the job. Now, he's a Christian. The man who told me this, the Christian man, his boss curses him out every day on the job. And he says, it's really hard for me not to retaliate. And it's hard for me not to be mean. Because he said, every day of my life, my boss curses me out. Maybe somebody is in a situation like that. Now, see, and it's easy to be angry. We live in a rotten and a mean society. That's the society in which we live. It's mean. But now he says, now you're becoming bitter and you need to stop that and you need to get it out of your life. But he's saying the reason why you need to get it out of your life is because you'll never be filled with the Holy Spirit. See, you'll be grieving the Spirit. See, and so he says, grieve not the Holy Spirit of God. So I believe these are three basic things in relation to being filled with the Holy Spirit, very obviously and very clear. See, number one, we have to be dominated by the Word of God. See, the Word of God must be the authority in our lives. Not what somebody says, not what I want to do, not what I want to placate someone or please somebody, but the Word of God must be dominant in my life. Now, number two, you see, we certainly need to be people of prayer, amen? And everybody knows that. See, when we pray, we say to God, not my will, but thy will be done. Nobody can be filled with the Spirit unless they're a person of prayer. And I don't think it's not talking about you pray all day, all the time, but you know what it means. You have to be a person of prayer. You have to be a person who prays and asks God for his help. And if I don't pray and ask God for his help, how can I ever expect to be controlled by the Holy Spirit of God? And then, of course, say, grieve not the Holy Spirit. We have to get all known sin out of our lives. Say, grieve not the Holy Spirit. Say, if I entertain sin in my life, whereby I know it's wrong, but I feed the flesh and I do it anyway, see, I can never be filled with the Holy Spirit of God. See, I grieve the Holy Spirit. That's why all that teaching that nobody's perfect, everybody has sin in their life, and so forth. But now, see, what's the Bible teach? See, that we're all sinners saved by grace. There's nobody perfect in the sight of God. But at the same time, the Bible teaches that it is our responsibility to repent and confess all known sin in our lives. Amen? See, I can never be filled with the Spirit if I say, Lord, well, I know this is wrong, but I do it anyway. See, we can't be controlled by the Holy Spirit if that's our attitude. See, it's impossible. So we need to confess and repent of all known sin in our lives. And see, in the Old Testament, we have so many great examples of this. I think of David in the Old Testament. When David sinned, you remember in Psalm 51, he said, take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Now, you see, that was in the Old Testament where he would lose the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit would depart from him. That's not true in the New Testament because we were indwelt by the Holy Spirit in the New Testament. But when David got right with God, see, then the Spirit of God was renewed in his life, you see. And he had that renewed fullness of the Holy Spirit. You find other times in the life of David that David sinned. And especially in the fact where he was so proud when he numbered the nation of Israel. And that was a matter of pride. Say, look how big our nation is. Look how great I've made our nation. Now, and that was the sin of pride in the life of David. Some believe that he numbered the people to find out how great an army he could have. So he'd depend on his army rather than on God. But now you see, that was the greatest sin that David ever committed, according to his own admission. In 1 Chronicles chapter 21, you read about it. And he said, I have sinned greatly against God. Now, as a result of that, his pride, God judged the nation by slaying 70,000 people. Now, when you read about that in 1 Chronicles chapter 21, what you find is that David repented. He got his heart right with God. Now, in all probability, that was a sin of pride. See, boasting. Thinking how great he was as the king of Israel. I made this nation. No, David did not make that nation. It was God who blessed them if they had any goodness or blessing. So, but David had to repent. See, and you see this over and over again in the Word of God. See, when we sin, we need to repent. By the way, that's very interesting. Check it out and you'll get a blessing in 1 Chronicles chapter 20, 21, 22. And because, see, the Bible says there was a sword over the head of David until he repented. See, there was a sword over his head. God's judgment was upon that nation until David repented. See, we need to repent. We can't have any known sin in our lives. If we have known sin in our lives, we can never be controlled and filled with the blessed Holy Spirit of God. Now, again, what's the result of being filled with the Holy Spirit? And again, in Ephesians chapter 5, he's talking there about wives. If someone is filled with the Holy Spirit, they will be a better wife. Ephesians chapter 5, and we read there in verse 22. Ephesians 5:25. If you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you'll be a better husband. See, that's the ministry of the Holy Spirit. See, that's a result of the Holy Spirit. It will be evidenced in a person's life. In other words, the Holy Spirit will make a person a better person. That's the ministry of the Holy Spirit, to make us Christ-like, amen? To make us like our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and you read there in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, it's talking about spiritual gifts, which we've been dealing with in Sunday school and Sunday morning. But he says, but covet earnestly the best gifts. But then he says in chapter 12 and verse 31, and yet I show you a more excellent way. So he's saying, I'm showing you something better than spiritual gifts. And then he goes on and gives a great chapter on agape love in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. So what does the Bible teach? See, the gifts of the Spirit are not as important as the fruit of the Spirit. Now, turn to Galatians chapter 5. See, and in Galatians chapter 5, and we read here in verse 22, Galatians 5 and verse 22, but the fruit of the Spirit. Now we're talking about being filled with the Holy Spirit. How do you know someone is filled with the Holy Spirit? You have nine things, the Bible says, that result in the life of someone filled with the Holy Spirit. And he does not say, talk here about speaking in tongues. He doesn't talk here about rolling over on the floor. He's not talking about anything spectacular. Now, he's talking about the result, the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And what is the fruit of the Holy Spirit? See Galatians 5 and verse 22. Now, say love, joy, peace. Now, all of us would agree that we'd much rather experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit than the gifts of the Holy Spirit. In other words, as good as the gifts of the Holy Spirit are, and I believe there are some wonderful gifts today that we read about, especially in Romans chapter 12. And they're not sign gifts, but they're gifts today. But as important as a gift may be, what's more important is the fruit of the Spirit. See, and what's the fruit of the Spirit? See, love, joy. See, Galatians 5:22. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, referring to faithfulness, meekness, and temperance. Now, they're the gift, not the gifts, but the fruit of the Spirit. Which would you rather have, a gift of the Spirit or the fruit of the Spirit? And all of us would be agreed, we need the fruit of the Spirit, amen? Say, I want to have the love of Christ in my life. I want to have God's joy in the midst of trials, difficulties, because we're all going to go through trials, difficulties. And then peace. See, you can't put a price tag on those things. Now, it's very interesting when you read there, one of the gifts of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 is, you see what it says in verse 22? Goodness. What does that mean? See, the fruit of the Spirit, one of the, and it's a fruit singular of the Spirit, because this is the Spirit wants to give you all these things. And but one of those things that are mentioned is the fruit of the Spirit is goodness. What does that mean? What's it mean? Goodness is a fruit of the Spirit. What does that mean to you? What does that mean to me? See, that's a fruit of the Spirit. In other words, if someone's controlled by the Holy Spirit, they'll be a good person. Practically speaking. Anybody have a thought here? You see, the Holy Spirit's always going to make a person a better person. Make you a better person. I believe a great illustration of this is there in Luke chapter 10, and we in verses 30 through 36. Remember, Jesus gave the parable of the Good Samaritan. And remember, the religious people, the Levite and the priest, they saw this guy, and the Bible says he was half dead, and he had wounds. Now, if you're going down the road, walking down your street, and you see someone who's half dead and they have wounds, and these nice religious people walk by him. They said, oh man, he's got trouble. And they didn't help him. And then the Bible says a Samaritan, see, a non-Jew. A Samaritan saw him, and this is a parable, in Luke chapter 10 in verse 30 through 36, of the Good Samaritan. And we all know what the Good Samaritan did. See, he helped him. And the Bible says he put oil and wine in his wounds. By the way, see, he didn't send him to a faith healer. He didn't say, God, heal this man right now. He didn't say anything. No, he gave him medicine. And then the Bible says he helped him, and he took him to an inn. And he told the guy in the inn there, in a hotel, whatever, and he says, just take care of him now, and make sure you take good care of him, and whatever it's going to cost you, I'll be back tomorrow, and I'll make sure to reimburse you for everything that you need to help that man. That's a good illustration of goodness, amen? See, if someone's filled with the Holy Spirit, they're not going to walk by somebody like that without helping them, without being a blessing to them. See, now, whether someone is saved or unsaved, see, that's the fruit of the Spirit. It helps a person to be a good person. See, goodness is a result. Now, see the point I'm getting? See, that's practical, amen? This is not talking about preaching the gospel in some foreign country. He's talking about helping your neighbor and being a blessing where you can be a blessing. See, there are people like that. They're filled with goodness. Where does that come from? The Holy Spirit of God. Amen. By the way, there's nothing wrong with a Christian being a good person. Amen. What's wrong with being a good person? What's wrong with being a nice person? See, that shows you're under the control of the Holy Spirit of God. And so we see that in the Word of God. And then the last thing that's mentioned there, the fruit of the Spirit, is temperance. And that's something, see, that's a word that means self-control. See, now that's the fruit of the Holy Spirit of God. Now, a lot of times, we don't exercise self-control. Now, see, if someone is controlled by the Holy Spirit, they will exercise self-control. And we all need that. And Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 9 that if you're going to be a good Christian, you must exercise self-control in your life, just like an athlete would exercise self-control. So you as a Christian need to exercise self-control. But a lot of times we don't emphasize that one. Amen? Do we need self-control? See, that's the fruit of the Spirit. See, it'll help somebody to exercise self-control. Habits, addictions. See, the Holy Spirit can help us in our bad habits and our addictions because the Holy Spirit can minister self-control or temperance in our lives. A friend of mine, in fact, he's preached here, and he said he used to preach every year down in a church in down there in Georgia. And he said that the pastors, there's two pastors there, they get together, and they'd always take them out to eat. And they had that place there where, you know, it's all you can eat, you know, like a buffet. But it's all you can eat, and especially chicken. Well, those preachers he was with, he said, they could down about 5 or 6 whole chickens themselves without exaggeration. And they were probably 150, 200 pounds overweight. And so he said, in fact, it was Joe Mark, and he said on the way out, they call them servers now. He used to call them waitresses, and so forth. So he said, I gave the server a good tip and a track. And the server said to me, those two men are not Christians. Now, they're pastors. She said, because no Christian would eat the way they eat. See, when you down 5 or 6 chickens, I mean, you really are, put it this way, you don't have any self-control. Now, you see what I'm getting at? You see, I don't think those men had self-control. You're 150, 200 pounds overweight. Are you filled with the Spirit? See, self-control is a fruit of the Spirit. See, that shows that we're controlled by the Holy Spirit. Now, everybody wants to lose 5-10 pounds, one thing or another. But when you're 150 to 200 pounds overweight, you don't know anything about the Holy Spirit. You have no indication about self-control. Amen? See, and but you see, the fruit of the Spirit is self-control. See, the fruit of the Spirit, if we're controlled by the Holy Spirit, he can give us victory over it. That's temperance. And see, we all need to ask. We have an addiction. We have a problem. We have a difficulty. See, we need to ask the Holy Spirit to help us. Amen? Lord, give me that self-control. Help me in this area of my life where I don't have self-control. See what we're getting at? See, being filled with the Holy Spirit, it's pretty practical, amen? It's right down where we live. You see, and that's why we all need the Holy Spirit, and we all need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Amen. So we just want to go over some, this is just some basic teaching about the Holy Spirit of God. You see, and what the Holy Spirit wants to do primarily is make me a better person, a better individual, a better Christian. Primarily, someone says, well, I want to hoot and holler and carry on, and that means I'm filled with the Holy Spirit. No. See, according to Galatians 5:22, see, gentleness, that's another fruit of the Spirit. But see, according to Galatians 5:22, see, the main thing, the fruit, which is more important than any gifts of the Spirit, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, last verse in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, see, the Holy Spirit simply wants to make all of us Christ-like. As someone has said, those nine fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5:22 is a description of Jesus Christ. See, and the Holy Spirit wants to produce Christ in our lives, Christ-likeness in our lives. See, what we're getting at, the Holy Spirit is practical. Holy Spirit is right where you live and right where I live to make me a better person and more like the Lord Jesus Christ. See, that's what the Holy Spirit is all about. Well, I trust that God will speak to our hearts. Let's